Yo, is it just me or am I getting downward spiral vibes from this?
Bit wasn't even that funny. Why did I think this was a good idea?
I forgot to buy the stand for this. Perfect. Hey yo, welcome back to another video. In our last episode of A Chemical Dude Talks About the Meaning of a Song, we talked about Mr. Self-Destruct and how it's an introduction to the themes we see in the rest of the downward spiral. My glasses are so fogged up. Do you see this? Like, I can't even see out of them. Now that video's doing okay and people seem to like it, so I've decided I'm gonna be making another, but the next issue arose. What do I cover next? Do I go through the whole downward spiral? Do I go through a random song I like? Do I even stick with Nine Inch Nails? Well, the answers were respectively sorta, no, and yes. This video, you already know, you read the title, but in case you're a goldfish and have no memory, today we're gonna be going over the story of the downward spiral. Before we start, short disclaimer, obviously this album covers heavy topics like addiction, depression, suicide, so just like last time, click off if you don't want to hear about that. Also, it's very important to note that the downward spiral definitely has a few inarguable points, and the story has a few things that are set in stone, but most of this is just going to be my interpretation. So if you think a song has a different meaning to the story, that's perfectly fine, and I would also love to hear it in the comments. But for right now, I'm just going to be going over how I interpret the story based off some of the lyrics, musical cues, musical cues, and also the context of the time. I am sweating so much. As many of you know, the Downward Spiral is presented as a concept album, sort of like Year Zero, but Year Zero is way more in-depth, and the idea of ever talking about that story just terrifies me. But anyway, despite the Downward Spiral having a protagonist and a story being shown to us, it's also very much based in Trent's emotion and his struggles with depression and addiction at the time. Because of this, it's going to be pretty important to look at what we know about Trent at the time to sort of decipher and assume a few things. Understanding his mental state is a pretty big part of understanding the story. Now, in the last video, we talked about Mr. Self-Destruct pretty in-depth, so I'll keep this brief. Mr. Self-Destruct is an introduction to the album and an introduction to our character. The Mr. Self-Destruct is he's our protagonist. Of course, that's open to interpretation. You could argue Mr. Self-Destruct as a name refers to the depression and self-destructive habits that the character has. So, for now, we're not going to call him that because I don't want to say Mr. Self-Destruct over and over. We're just going to leave our protagonist unnamed for right now. In this song, we get hints our character's depressed, he abuses drugs, has some sort of sex addiction, and overall, he's just not in a great place. If this were a movie, Mr. Self-Destruct would be the opening scene where we meet the character, we get to know a little bit about him, we get to see his day-to-day life, we get to see him go to the store and get a bagel, we get to see him use heroin. So then our next song is Piggy, which is in a very stark contrast to the fast, hard-hitting, aggressive Mr. Self-Destruct. This is a slower, quieter, more sad, sometimes almost monotone song. We get a few lines that hint this song is about two things. Number one, the lyrics in the second verse. Really, those last few sentences are what we want to focus on right now. In this case, the pig is being used as a stand-in for someone that this character trusted, someone they loved or really believed in. It seems that the pig, or the character, betrayed trust at some point, leaving him hurt and betrayed, and it's never really clear what this person was, what their relationship to the protagonist was, or what they did. You know, that's open to interpretation. yeah, as things usually are, to make it better, but... If we assume it was someone he dated, we could assume that they either cheated on him, or they just broke up with him, and our character feels betrayed by this breakup. And, you know, again, it's open to interpretation, you know, when it's not just laid out straight, when it can be interpreted, it's a lot easier for us to put our own emotion and experiences on it. It helps us experience the album better. It's just, it's better songwriting. So, you know, who would have thought Trent Reznor knew how to write lyrics? What a shock that one is! Whoa! Now, in this song, we also repeatedly will get the phrase, "Nothing can stop me now," which is over and over, which is also joined by, "'Cause I don't care anymore." That's the chorus of the song. So clearly whatever happened has not only left our character feeling betrayed and hurt, but this relationship and was so important, and losing it was so painful that the character feels like there's nothing left to lose, that nothing can stop him because there's nothing to hold him back, there's nothing that could possibly hurt him anymore. And we see this exact thought repeated in Ruiner, which could mean it's safe to say Ruiner is likely about the same betrayal and character that we're talking about here, but we're going to get to that later. On our next stop of this wonderful tour of pain, we get Heresy and March of the Pigs, which go together quite well in terms of both their anger and their themes of hating. It's reasonable to assume that the thoughts presented here piggyback off each other, and piggyback, and piggy, because it's a pig, because pig, because a lot of times that they're gonna talk about pig. Like we remember back from Mr. Self-Destruct, religion is referred to as denial, guilt, and fear in that song, and then the prayers of the naive, lie you believe, so it's no secret that the protagonist holds a very deep disdain for religion, and basically thinks that if you believe in religion, you're stupid, you're living a lie, you suck. Now, this line is obviously, well, two things. Obviously, it's very antagonistic and made to very bluntly portray this anger. But it's also alluding to this protagonist losing faith they had and believing that this loving God we're told is real must be a lie. And it's a fair thought if you think about his state of mind. Someone with presumably untreated here depression, struggling with addiction, pretty much constantly suffering due to things they can't really control. The thought of, what God, would let my life be this terrible, is pretty normal for someone to have, especially at the low points of their depression. It can get really bad. Then the line, "no one cares," that confused me a bit whenever I'd listen to it. And I think it's, I think honestly, it's meant as sort of a fuck you, saying that no one cares about God, your faith is dumb. But I doubt Trent was actually hitting the books to make this song real and factual, but it does match the fact that in the 90s, less and less people were Christian. In 1993, when the song came out, Christianity was losing popularity among Americans. So, you know, maybe a bit of hyperbole, but good job with your facts, Trent. Heresy mostly continues to elaborate on how religion's a lie, how it's used for horrible things, how it's used to justify, you know, the atrocities done in his name, that's in the second verse, how, you know, perfect kingdom, killing, suffering, and pain, continuing the idea that not only is religion wrong and not real, but, oh, that's my place in the script. Continuing the idea that not only is religion wrong and not only is God dead, but religion can be pointed at as more of a real source of cruelty and evil in the world, and how we use God as a divine purpose to justify horrible things and that should never be done to anyone. Basically saying that, you know, religion can be blame a million other things, but if you go down to it, religion is the problem that we could blame for all the problems in the world. God, I need to write better. Next in March of the Pigs, we get what I always saw as, you know, and pretty much everyone, I would agree, would say is a general disdain for humanity, a big old fuck you to everyone. We get some hints at the character's state of mind here in later verses in a pretty interesting way. the name of the song is immediately alluding to this, like, it's a sense of superiority almost, like the character is saying everyone going along day to day is like, you know, a pig marching along their routines, again with the pig motif, you know, just viewing things as lesser, as pigs. Pigs are, again, being used as a metaphor for people that the protagonist hates, and the march is referred to in the first lines of the song. Stop right on! This pretty much proves our idea that the character here hates people and hates the society around him, that he sees the world as a pointless and mindless march to fulfill basic desires and needs, and nobody gives a shit who they hurt or push out of the way on their path to what they consider success. Our chorus then once again expands upon this idea with all the pigs all lined up, I give you all you want. So far, a lot of these songs have been about getting to know our character. There isn't much to say as far as a story, since a lot of these songs right now have just been giving insight to the character and his mind, rather than exploring specific actions that are taking place. Closer is really the first one that we could say is about some action taking place in the story, some events. Besides Hurt, Closer is probably one of the most famous Nine Inch Nails songs. Drum line is super simple, but still one of ridiculously iconic. You hear that drum beat, you pretty much know what is about to come. You know what song is coming up. The only thing more memorable and more controversial is the chorus. I wanna fuck you like an animal. You know, super explicit, super sexual, and obviously at the time super controversial, especially with parents being outraged, but that's not the point here. A lot of people will mistake this song for just being like a sex anthem, which, I mean, it has a catchy beat, super explicit sexual lyrics, and the really sexual feeling bass line. A lot of alternative clubs would even play this song, and people would dance to it. It got hugely popular But really, if you look at the lyrics, just with like a really simple second glance, you see that this is not just a song about sex. Well, yes, it is about sex, and sex is referenced. There's a lot more to it. It's about depression, and it's about self-hatred, and it's about using sex as like a coping mechanism. It's, I mean, help me get away from myself. My whole existence is flawed. You're gonna have my isolation. You make me perfect. Help me become somebody else. It's very clearly about this character hates himself, and he's depressed, and he uses sex to feel okay, to feel better. Let's assume for right now that the character we see referenced back in Piggy was, in fact, someone they were dating, and this character's partner. You know, it'd be reasonable to assume this song also talks about them then, how protagonist feels worthless and depressed and hates himself, but this other character makes them feel okay. They feel some self-worth when they're having sex. We also see that the protagonist is extremely dependent on this other person. Along with the lines we've already seen, the really distorted ending lyrics of the song has, you know, it ends with, "You are the reason I stay alive," which, I mean, works as the last line of the song, because it really brings the whole point home, that this character's depressed, he feels worthless, and honestly would probably kill himself, but they have this other character that, even if it's just through sex, brings some sort of meaning and self-worth to their life, and that, you know, without this, they hate everything, that this is pretty much one of the only times they feel okay. Ruiner, then, we say, is looking back at this character again, and we could say almost like Closer is sort of a bittersweet look back on a relationship, like, I felt good doing this, And now Ruiner is here to remind us that everything fucking sucks. Everything is so goddamn bad. Or we could say that if we ignored some of the lyrics. You see, lyrics such as the opening verse work out, since we could assume maybe after breaking up, mutual friends sided with the other character. You know, you had all of them on your side. You know, left the protagonist alone. The only issue is the Ruiner, several times throughout this song, is referred to as a he. Now, this obviously does not immediately discount the idea that this song was about a relationship, but Reptile does. You see, in Reptile, it's very clearly talking about this other character and the betrayal, and it's more of a hateful look at the character. And in Reptile, repeatedly, they're referring to this character as she and her throughout the whole song. So, it's impossible for these characters to be talking about the same person. So, we could say Ruiner is like our character's depression being personified, just like in Mr. Self-Destruct. But then that doesn't make any sense, because, you know, you had all them on your side, no one who the fuck is on depression's side. So, what exactly is Ruiner about? Well, I think it might not refer to the character's depression, but their self-destructive habits. More specifically, him pushing everyone away. He had everyone on his side, and probably hid things about himself, and thus, they believed all your lies. You see, this opening line isn't our protagonist speaking, it's this Ruiner speaking, I think. It's those thoughts in the back of this character's minds, like, you don't deserve friends, and subconsciously making this character push his friends and loved ones away. And then we switch to, like, a third-person point of view. It's like this is a narrator explaining what the Ruiner is and what it's doing. And then it's like we switch points of view again back to the protagonist. See, the protagonist has always had these thoughts. You know, depression didn't just come pop up one day, hey, it's me, I'm gonna ruin your life. But he could push them down and sort of hold himself together, but now he can't. Thus, how'd you get so big? How'd you get so strong? You know, this, oh my god, what the fuck? I could hold this back. What is this? Where did this come from? Then, in the next verse, with giving them all a sign, covet what was mine. This time the verse is being sang by our protagonist again, talking to this Ruiner instead of the other way around. You know, noticing, pointing out the Ruiner gave everyone these signs to leave, and basically the self-destructive habits fucking took everything away. Coveting, you know, taking away friendships, relationships, taking everything good away. So we have something else on our timeline now. Our protagonist has begun to push everyone away, ruin his relationships. He's making himself be alone. Then we're back to exploring the mind of our character, rather than actions with the becoming. A lot of these songs are really going to be more about the mind of the character, but the thing is, seeing these glimpses into the mind can really help us assume, you know, some of the actions that are taking place. Now, The Becoming always stood out lyrically to me, even at a really young age, when I was listening to this, probably when I shouldn't have been listening to this, actually. It seemed odd to me that in this realistic and grounded portrayal of depression and, you know, downward spiral, we suddenly got this song about someone being replaced with robotic parts and losing his humanity, and I always loved this song, but it confused the hell out of me, because I didn't look at it as the metaphor that it really is. The song is not literally a story about someone changing into a machine. It's not Styx, Mr. Roboto. It's not... That's not what that song is about. What the hell am I talking? This song is not about literally changing someone to a machine. It's not literally about someone becoming like a cyborg. It's rather the machine is a metaphor for a character after experiences depression. It's this... I don't want to say worse version of himself, but sort of like a worse version of him. And the machine even makes sense as a metaphor, because the machine's this unfeeling, emotionless, cold, and a lot of times, if you're severely depressed, you similarly will, you know, be distant, you're not gonna show emotion, a lot of times you're cold towards people, you can emotionally shut down. That would be why a man-to-machine transformation is used as a metaphor here. The song is using this, the me that you know, the returning motif throughout this entire song, as the version of this character that, you know, was holding things together, that, you know, was sort of okay, that had some control. But then the song is very clear, pretty much immediately, that this version of the protagonist is gone and replaced with this new version that shut everyone out and became someone new, because that's kind of what happens. Depression changes you. When you're depressed, you will act differently. As I explained before, it's a really fucking awful, dark experience. And, you know, you're becoming someone new, someone who acts different. Continuously, we're seeing this character deteriorating mental state. We've gone from he's betrayed and he's upset to he hates religion. Now he hates humanity. He only ever felt good while having sex. Now the character doesn't even say they're human. Like, things are completely different. Things are fucked. So, I do not want this. Seems to almost be like a sort of check-in with the character. Like, it's an update on exactly how they're doing. And, who would have guessed that they're not doing very good. Throughout the song, they're talking to someone that could be whoever they dated, or maybe even a therapist. Whoever they're talking to, it's somebody who's trying to help them. The song opens with a character talking to this other person. Losing ground. Well, you know how this world can beat you down. Then the chorus comes in. It's an almost weak or shaky voice at first, saying, I do not want this, before it breaks into anger, saying, you know, don't you tell me how I feel. This person cannot tell me how I feel. They don't know how I feel. The protagonist is angry and defensive now when offered this help. Once again, it's this character's being self-destructive, pushing people away. Even when someone knows what's going on and tries to help, he'll push them away. And I want to go back to the last lines of that, though. 2 feet below the surface, I can still make out your wavy face. If I could just reach you, maybe I could leave this place. Not only is it important to see the lyrics, but also listen to how they're sung. It's distorted and quiet, and it doesn't sound like in control. This is the part of our protagonist that does want help. Because it's not that you completely don't want to be helped. When you're depressed, when you're like this, when you're pushing everyone away, you do want to be happy. And it's like our character is split now between this weaker version of himself now that's losing control and wants to be helped. And he knows that he could if he could just reach the person and talk to them, try to get help. but, you know, the way that it's sung, the way that it's portrayed, it's very clear that this character is kind of losing control of what of themselves. You know, the place he wants to leave is this horrible mental state that is their mind, and it's they can't control it anymore, and this other version of themselves is the angry voice pushing people away. And it seems like at this point, the protagonist is pretty much fighting himself. Two sides of his mind, one that's feeding the self-destruction, one that wants to ruin everything, the side of him that makes him feel terrible, you know. Then there's the side that knows he needs help, that does want to feel better. Oh my god. Then there's this side that, you know, does know he needs help. He wants to feel better. He wants to fix his life, but that latter side of his mind is rapidly losing control. The steering wheel being stolen by the destructive side of him and that wants to completely ruin him. Then we move on to Big Man with a Gun, and it's been described by Trent as representing insanity or madness. To me, the downward spiral builds to a certain degree of madness. Then it changes. That would be the last stage of delirium. So, the original point of Big Man with a Gun was madness. He goes on to say the song is sort of making fun of the misogyny and abuse and gangster rap at the time. But for the purpose of this analysis, we're going to take that and then push it away. We're going to ignore that for right now. Because that doesn't really have much to do with our story. So if we take this song at face value and put it into the story, it is definitely the character being insane and losing it. And honestly, if you take what is said in this song, it is incredibly fucked up. I don't want to talk about this one, man. Basically, the lyrics sort of allude to, It alludes to the character holding the gun to the head of someone, presumably the woman from earlier, and forcing her to have sex with him and raping her before probably murdering her. And, obviously this is insanely fucked up and would mark a point of no return. This character would be irredeemably fucking horrible after that, which is why I took this and I looked at it and I was like, at first I did look at it as this literal telling of events, but I realized that, you know, that would just make this character a complete piece of fucking shit. So I looked it back over and see if I was missing something. And I think I was. I don't think this actually is the character doing these things. See, it was a point of madness, but I don't think it was a point of being fucking evil. It's still fucked up, but rather than doing it, this is a character having, like, a power fantasy of doing these things. I mean, it sort of makes sense if you look at the context of the story and where this character is. It's total madness and insanity, so the actions being imagined are clearly not rational or reasonable or okay in any sort of way. It, you know, we know that this character has, you know, that using sex as a coping mechanism or even an addiction to it and closer. We know that he feels weak from I Do Not Want This. So, I mean, it does seem like this song could just represent a power fantasy. This desperate desire to be in control and take what he wants. I don't think our character really does these things. I think this is what we heard, and I Do Not Want This, you know, I lay inside my bed, I've lived so many lives all in my head. So we know our character has sat there and imagined scenarios and lives, and so this is just his new fucked up fantasy of power and control and hurting other people. And, I mean, look, man, I just don't want this song to be fucking literal. It's so fucked up if it's literal, but I don't think it is. I think it makes a lot more sense, because there's no fucking way that we would go from this horrible, horrible shit to feeling sympathy for him and hurt. So I think that this is like this is just a fantasy of a basically fucking insane person. So then, in even more stark contrast than Piggy was to Mr. Self-Destruct, we get A Warm Place from Big Man with a Gun. And it can be kind of hard to decipher the meaning of an instrumental song, but we can use the name, context of the story, placement of the song in the album to figure out what it could represent. Now, remember how in the Mr. Self-Destruct video, if you don't remember it because you didn't watch it, you should go watch it. I think it's a pretty good video. That the opening track, Mr. Self-Destruct, it referenced drug abuse very, very, very blatantly, needle in your vein. So, and then I said, there's no song that really references drug abuse like every other topic is referenced. I think that actually this is the song referencing drug abuse. It's ridiculously stark contrast. It's the most abrupt transition in the entire album. It's really beautiful and dark, but it's sort of comforting in a strange way. And a warm place, so it's a feeling of a high, okay? It seems like this whole thing is alluding to the feeling of, like, a high. How everything is gonna feel okay for a moment, and how the pain is numbed by the drugs. Obviously, this could be argued. You could say this song represents character somberly looking back at his life, and that the song is reflective, and I definitely see that. This song does sound really sort of reflective and retrospective. For the longest time, I sort of thought that too, but after looking at Mr. Self-Destruct and thinking, hey, it's kind of weird that every topic gets its own song besides drug abuse, I think this is, you know, I think this is pretty much, you know, this is me being unable to talk. This is the song that references our character abusing drugs to feel okay. Eraser, I think, comes right after it in a very good way that kind of hammers it home. You see, Eraser is like a come down. It's directly after Warm Place, chronologically, just like it is in the album. And this is where the character is looking back on his life, not A Warm Place. And it makes sense, because we know our character hates his life, so it makes sense that this angrier, darker, more disturbing-sounding, more unsettling-sounding one, it fits a lot better to a retrospective look back on life than the warm sounds, the comforting sounds of A Warm Place before. Most of the song is instrumental, and I would say that is specifically the character coming down from the high. It gets more chaotic, more loud, more angry, more distorted as it goes on, you know, as things wear off, as you come back to reality, and everything is shit again. And since the lyrical section isn't very long, I'll play the whole thing right here. Notice how the song suddenly becomes softer and quieter as the character thinks back about this person they, you know, dreamed of, needed, again, this person they were with. It's become increasingly clear that our character was completely dependent on this person that they loved, that this person was pretty much all that was holding them together, and now that they're gone, he's left alone, and thus begins the downward spiral, deeper and deeper and... Thus begins my fucking inability to talk! Thus begins the downward spiral, deeper and deeper into depression. At first, you know, the lyrics are soft, but as they get more aggressive, the song starts to pick up until, once again, exploding into the distorted, noisy guitars and huge drums as the lyrics are once again being screamed as he talks about himself and seemingly what was done to him. He sees this other person leaving as just completely horrible, thus lose me, hate me, smash me, erase me, then... You know, followed by Kill Me, which is screamed over and over as the character, breaks down. It gets more distorted and buried under the louder and louder instruments, more distorted, more chaotic than ever, totally overtaking any other thoughts. And it is worth pointing out that, yes, it does sound like at the end, the words Help Me are stacked on top of Kill Me. And I watched a few videos, which... all kind of picked it apart. I watched multi-track videos. I watched that Ixie video, which is still pretty good. And I'm still shouting out a fucking channel with 300 times my goddamn subscribe. Oh, I looked at all of these, and I looked in depth, and I was like, okay, maybe they're all somehow fucking stupid. No, that's not what it is. But I did want to double check. So I went, and I got the stems, and there is no track saying help me. There is, however, a distorted version of the vocals of him saying kill me that's super eroded and distorted. And I think in the mix, it just sort of combines to sound like it, because the erosion does sort of make it sound like the H sound at the beginning, and the rest is just an auditory illusion, I think. And on top of this... it's just been shared around as, like, a fact. Like, hey, did you know that it says help me at the end of Eraser? So it's even easier to perceive it as that when you're listening for it. So, no, it doesn't say help me, even though that would be pretty cool. But also, if we're thinking about this in the timeline, wouldn't really make sense. Because the last cries for help were in I Do Not Want This, pretty much, before pushing everyone away. Reptile is our last time thinking about this relationship, and while it does explain a few things, it also sort of raises a few questions.
She spreads herself wide open to let the insects in.
So it seems pretty clear that the insects are a metaphor for other men having sex with the woman, and Seeds from a Thousand Others references the fact that this was not one person, that this was supposedly a considerable amount of people she was having sex with. The chorus raises my question, though.
I am so pure.
see to me the chorus mixed with the fact that the opening verse says it was a lot of other people raised the question in my mind originally when I was first listening. And I was sort of wondering, were these two characters ever actually together? Because by definition, whore, which is used to refer to this woman, is a prostitute by definition. And yes, it is used as a derogatory term for women, but this mixed with the fact that the song claims she slept with that many different people brought up the possibility in my mind that our protagonist was in fact addicted to sex, paid a prostitute, and then out of loneliness, desperation, and sort of delusion, fell in love with her. And then we sort of get this hint later, need to contaminate to alleviate this loneliness. So it seems that maybe this wasn't ever a real relationship, and on top of other mental issues, this protagonist was kind of delusional, believed he was dating her, and the betrayal was just her doing what she's always done. And this all was just him desperately wishing he was with her, and he's angry at her for not wanting him back, even though she isn't dating him and has been doing this since before she met him, and he sees her sleeping with other people as a betrayal. And obviously, if this is the case, our character was completely irrational from the start, and while I think that this is a possibility, I think it's more likely that A Thousand Others is just an extreme exaggeration and hyperbole, and whore is just being used, to be derogatory towards her. Since this song is very clearly about the disdain he holds towards her and anger, while all the other songs referencing this relationship sort of had some positive light to it still, you know, about her being the good thing that was in his life, the sort of happiness, but this song is just fucking pissed, and it's all about hatred now. So while I did think it was interesting to kind of bring up this idea, I think once I really looked back at it, that was not really what's going on. Last two tracks of this are the title track, The Downward Spiral, and Hurt. And both of these occupy similar spaces in the story. You know, this is the end. This is the lowest of the low, bottom of the spiral. In fact, there's an alternate version of the title track called The Downward Spiral, The Bottom, on the deluxe edition of the album. So, you know, this is very clear. This is the end of our story. Really, no sugarcoating it. This song is the character's suicide, or at least their suicide attempt. The lyrics are pretty much just a blunt retelling of events. Normally, with such actions being displayed, that would be the end. Our character's dead, but not quite. We still have Hurt. Hurt is just such a fantastic song, and I'm gonna make a whole video dedicated to it because it is so goddamn amazing, and there's so much to talk about, and I couldn't get into it all here. As far as the story, Hurt being after the downward spiral kind of implies the suicide attempt failed, and that's left the character injured or hurt, you know? This is very possible, but personally, I think in this instance, the songs might be out of order chronologically. The events going on in Hurt could take place before the title track, which is actually the end of the story, where, you know, it says he shoots himself. And just like Mr. Self-Destruct, fittingly enough, Hurt is an overview of everything. But instead of just looking at the character and the issues the character has, the themes of the album, Hurt is now the character looking back, instead of just R looking at the character. It's almost like maybe the character's looking back, you know, looking for something, some reason, you know, that life is worth living, but then, you know, he refers to his life as, you know, an empire of dirt, that he really feels he has nothing, that his self-destructive habits, that his depression, that everything he's done has completely ruined his life. He pushed everyone away, refused help, hurt himself, got worse and worse until he was left here, completely hopeless, giving up on life. And this is, without a doubt, the fucking saddest song on the whole album, and probably one of the saddest songs Nine Inch Nails has ever created, only rivaled, to me at least, by The Great Below. Like I said, I'll delve more into this song's lyrics in a separate video, but to understand the story, it's really just important to understand this as a character looking back on his life. So now we have a basic understanding of everything, and the meaning of the songs, we now can make a timeline. So the girlfriend of this protagonist cheats and or leaves him, beginning this spiral. He starts pushing people away and getting more distant as he gets worse and worse, and then eventually turns to drugs as he gets really depressed just to try and numb his pain. When someone tries to help him, he pushes them away. His mental state then gets worse and worse until his mind is just this chaotic mess of madness and fantasizes about hurting and killing people, specifically the women that he feels wronged him or did wrong him. Again, it's kind of open-ended. He completely despises everything and everyone around him. He hates the world, especially this other person. He continues getting worse and worse until he resolves to kill himself. And right before he does it, reflects on his life, can't find anything to live for, and kills himself. Wow, what a fun and upbeat story. Great for the whole family. No, but really, I meant it when I said this album story is dark as fuck. There is no happy ending, and that's kind of why I love it. The Downward Spiral is a brutally fucking honest depiction of depression and addiction being told by someone who struggled through all those things. He's not sugarcoating it. He's not changing it to be nicer or more accessible. That's why it's so amazing. It's also why everyone, including Trent, expected it to fail commercially. And honestly, thankfully, it didn't. In fact, at that point, it sold better than any other Nine Inch Nails album had. Faster than any other Nine Inch Nails album, selling millions of copies all over the world, reaching so many people who felt alone and had this album to release some emotion and know that, you know, they weren't alone. All that and so much more is why I think The Downward Spiral is probably one of the best albums ever made, and I could talk about it for hours, and maybe I will make a video just about why I think The Downward Spiral is so great. But for now, this has just been the story of The Downward Spiral. I hope you enjoyed and agree with my interpretation and analysis. But of course, if you disagree with any of my points and have your own thoughts, I'd love to hear them. Please do share it in the comments. I really would love to know what other people think about the story, what they thought songs meant, if you thought any song had a different meaning. If you enjoyed, please consider liking and subscribing so you can see my next videos on Nine Inch Nails and even more. If you have a song that you think I should analyze or look at, also comment that, and I will see you in the next video.